afternoon, everybody. I am Shelley Broderick, the proud dean of the UDC David A. Clarke School of Law, your tax dollars at work. I am delighted to welcome all of you, and I see such a great group here. We have undergraduate students, raise your hands. UDC undergrads. We had some.
They had another class.
Oh, okay. They were here, I promise. I am not making this up. UDC board member, Shelton. We're both Sheltons, so we rock that way. And many, many other alums and students and faculty and staff, and it's very nice to have everybody here. This is important work that we have undertaken, and we wanted to let you know much, much more about it. So I'm going to very briefly kick us off. Many, many years ago, in 1986-87, the DC Council decided to take Antioch Law School and turn it into the DC School of Law, make it the public law school for the District of Columbia. And we decided who should be on the board by designation. I know you know where I'm going with this. And one of the designated slots was for the immediate past president of the DC Law. And so there was a little controversy because it took quite a long time for the mayor to appoint, you know, for it all to come to being. And so there were kind of two potential immediate past presidents of the DC Bar who might get the job. And I think they flipped for it. Did you flip for it? No.
I decided he was much better.
So Fred Abramson, who notwithstanding that name is actually African American, and was the first or second African-American president of the DC Bar, was the winner who got to be the on the board of the law school and ultimately chair of the board of the law school. But Paul got to know us, Judge Friedman got to know us from the very beginning, because, you know, Fred Abramson was a guy who got everybody involved in important things. So when Fred unfortunately passed away, I believe 60 of his nearest and dearest friends came together in a board of the Frederick B. Abramson Foundation. And I see Joyce Batips is a board member, Bill Robinson, our law founding dean, was a board member for many years. I was a board member, and we had term limits, and so we were on the board for a maximum of 6 years, which meant you were on for every single minute of 6 years. And that's how I met and really got to know Andy Marks. So Andy, Paul, and I were all on this board and have known each other ever since. And so it just goes to show, students, it's good to get on boards and network and get to know people, because wonderful things can come up. So with that, let me say, our panel today, I'll begin in the middle with Judge Paul Friedman, who is a judge on the D.C. Federal Court for the District of Columbia, and a wonderful judge, and he presided over the Black Farmers case since 1997. He's been involved in this case. Andy Marks is co-lead counsel and former president of the DC Bar also. They have that in common. And he and I serve together on the Access to Justice Commission, and he is also on the board with Joyce Bajan of the School of Law. And so we have very good friends of the law school with us today. And we have a new friend, Alva Waller. She's here now and she's not allowed to leave. She is the Deputy Ombudsman in this case and was in the Leadership Washington class with Associate Dean Anna Maria Stewart and now part of the family. We also have two alums from the class of 2008, and they were together in the low-income taxpayer clinic in 2007. It's amazing, and Amanda Dunlap, all the way down, is the director of the clinic, and Craig Batchelor is the head of the Black Farmers Discrimination Project here at the law school. So we're going to kick this off by asking Judge Friedman to give us a little bit of background about this amazing landmark case.
Now you can hear me, I hope. Well, I didn't know it was going to be an amazing landmark case when it started. I became a federal judge in 1994, and in August of 1997, I got this lawsuit. And all of our cases are assigned randomly, and this was a lawsuit brought by Timothy Pigford of North Carolina, Lloyd Schaefer of Mississippi, George Hall of Alabama, who were three farmers. And they wanted to speak for lots of other African-American farmers in the South when they filed this suit, and he said it was a class action. The lawyer whom they got was a guy named Al Pyres. Al Pyres had been an antitrust lawyer at the Justice Department. He was not a civil rights lawyer. I don't know if he'd been further south than Delaware and D.C. in his life, but he did know a lot about agriculture cases in the agriculture department. He litigated a lot of these cases. He took this case, and he didn't know what he was getting himself into when he was interested. And they cited in their complaint a report from the Department of Agriculture Civil Rights Action Team, which basically said, to paraphrase, that African American farmers had been discriminated against for decades, discriminated against in farm loans, discriminated against in farm subsidies, and discriminated against when they filed complaints with USDA about discrimination. Their complaints were literally and figuratively thrown in the wastebasket for years. And this was all well documented. So at about the time the lawsuit was filed, and I don't know exactly how this happened, President Clinton and Dan Glickman, who was the Secretary of Agriculture, in this case was called Pigford versus Glickman because he was the Secretary of Agriculture. They got very interested in what was going on, and Clinton said, I want something done about this. So Congress started to hold a hearing. And at the same time, the lawsuit was beginning. And it was very clear that this was going to be a big deal. I certified, I can't remember the chronology exactly, but I certified this and suggested that they ought to start settling this case. A number of civil rights lawyers and other lawyers from the South wanted to be a part of the case. And Pyres said to them, I will accept anybody in as my co-counsel if you'll abide by the same rules that I'm going to abide by, which is I'm not going to take one dime from any single plaintiff, because there are provisions in the law that if you prevail in cases like this, there will be attorney's fees. And that's what I'm going to do. Anybody else who wants in, fine. And a lot of lawyers from the South did Hank Sanders, who's still in the case, Daniel mentioned him later, and his wife Rose, and a wonderful man named J.L. Chestnut, who had been one of Martin Luther King's lawyers, played a huge role in this case. They all came into the case. And so we are there, and it's a class. We don't know how many people are in the class. I think the case should settle. And I tell the Justice Department I think they ought to sit down and start to settle this case. And I remember very distinctly that Mike Sitkoff from the Justice Department, who's a terrific lawyer and represented his client very well in the Department of Agriculture, but also a very fair and decent guy about it. He said, well, I am willing to sit down and talk settlement, but I have a particular mediator in mind whom I want, because I've worked with him in another case, and his name's Michael Lewis, another small world, whom George Shelley and I know, who is also on the Abramson board, also African. And Pyres says, well, I don't know Michael Lewis, so I'm just not so sure. And I said, Mr. Pyres, you get on the phone this afternoon, you call Michael Lewis, you meet with him today, you come back tomorrow, you will like him, you will agree. And, of course, that happened. The other thing that happened early on,
he would have liked Michael even without the judicial director.
Right. Even without a judge telling him, you will like him. I said, I want to go to trial. I said, okay. He said, discovery's going to take a couple of years. I said, I'm ordering you, I think this was in writing, to turn over all of the documents within 3 weeks. He says, there are tens of thousands of documents all over the place. I said, well, Secretary Glickman was up on the Hill yesterday. I read in the paper this morning. And he said that he's ordered all the documents from all the offices all over the country to be sent to Washington so they can review them here. So as soon as Secretary Glickman gets them, I want you to give them. So then they started to talk stuff. And created this, and then there was JL, who was you would have had to have known JL Chestnut, who, as I said, represented Martin Luther King, Alabama. JL, yeah, of course. Mr. Sitkoff doesn't want to settle. I'll go to trial. I'm willing to go to trial anytime he wants to go to trial. And I said, Mr. Sitkoff, do you really want to go to trial here in this courtroom against Mr. Chestnut? I've been called a lot of things, Judge, but I've never been called a fool. So the settlement worked out. It took a lot of time. Michael could tell you chapter and verse. Alva knows a little bit about it. And this structure was put in place, which the Justice Department, I think, later regretted. And it's one of the reasons the process took about a dozen years. And it's unfortunate. And Andy will tell you why the current structure is not taking as long. And in some ways, it's preferable, and in some ways, not. But essentially, you had a choice. And your choice was you could file a claim. You could either go track A or track B. We're dealing with thousands of farmers, some of whom are illiterate. Some of them have big farms, but a lot of them are small family farms. And I can't remember the statistic, you can tell me, but you know, shortly after the Civil War and the Freedmen's Bureau was set up, and every former slave who wanted to farm was given 40 acres and a mule. And that's how I began my opinion, in which I approved the settlement. I said, 40 acres and a mule. This was the promise. It had been delivered by the Agriculture Department. I don't know if you know the numbers, but there were tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of farmers and hundreds of thousands of acres, which because of the failures to provide loans and subsidies and other reasons, and probably other demographic things like people living in the big cities and all those sorts of things, the number of farmers decreased, the number of farmland decreased, and they were struggling. So a lot of these farmers were illiterate, didn't have a lot of money, and were not individuals who kept careful records of all the transactions. So they didn't have records necessarily of their efforts to get loans and being turned down. So the settlement agreement provided, believe it or not, those of you who are in law school have taken the administrative law, provided that if you are in track A, your burden of proof is less than a preponderance of the evidence. It is substantial evidence in the record, which is what you get in an administrative law case, which is, could go either way, but if there's something that supports you. So you had to show, through an affidavit or otherwise, by yourself, and a second affidavit from another person, not a relative, that you applied for a loan or a subsidy in a given year, that you didn't get it, and that the white farmer down the road did get a similar loan or subsidy. And if you prove that, that's all you need to do. You won your claim. Now the deal was, and it was done on paper, there were no hearings, but it also provided that you got $50,000 plus $12,500 in injunctive relief, tax relief, which was the $12,500 because you had to pay taxes on it, and forgiveness of any loans that you did get that were somehow tied to the discriminatory loans, and priorities for future loans. That's a pretty good deal, although there were a lot of people who complained. But we lost a lot more than $50,000, or my parents or grandparents. But as JL said many times publicly and in meetings around the South, $62,000 and priority for future loan comes is a hell of a lot better than zero. And that's what people are going to get. And so Al Pyres and his team and went out throughout the South and held numerous meetings and filled out claims for. And the one mistake that Al made was to say, proving a substantially similarly situated white farmer is going to be the easy part. We'll be able to do that. Well, that was hard. And getting the claims forms done, it was hard. And so the deadlines came, and the Justice Department agreed to one extension, and they said, that's it, we built these deadlines in, that's it. And my law clerk at the time came up with a brilliant idea. And those that have been in this case for a while still sing his praises. And that is, well, why don't we tell them they can file a bare-bones claim and supplement it later? And the claim was filed by the deadline, and then we set this schedule of 100 supplements every week for it. The Justice Department was livid, but did not make the it happened. That was track A. Track B, if you really thought you could prove your case, you had a mini-discovery and a mini-one-day trial before Michael Lewis and others whom he engaged, who were, you know, well-established, well-regarded arbitrators, mediators. And then the sky was the limit on what you could get. And there was actually one judgment for $1 million.
No, there was one for $15 million.
$15 million?
Yeah, one.
So, and then there was the all of this was fine. Last thing I wanted was the media, thousands and thousands. But the settlement created something called the monitor. And the monitor had the authority to review. You could petition for review to the monitor, and she would look at everything. And she then, if she concluded there was manifest injustice, she wrote an opinion that explained manifest injustice in a way so that the person who looked at it next, the track A arbitrator, adjudicator, would know what to do to correct it. Then there was another issue. Could the monitor accept supplemental evidence that was never in the original claims package? Because the claims packages were put together. So, of course, the Justice Department said, no, you're changing the rules of the game midstream. And I issued an order saying you could accept supplemental. Once again, they didn't appeal. And I don't know the inner machinations of the Justice Department and Michael Sitcom. But, you know, again, those of you that have studied class actions or settlements or whatever, a settlement agreement mutually agreed to, approved by a court, is a court order. But it is also a contract. And like any other contract, it can't be unilaterally changed by one side.
Or by the court.
Or by the court. The court can, there's some law on this. You can make minor changes, but, you know, so, and Andy will talk about some of the things that happened in the second case. But for the Justice Department to decide not to take an appeal when I made certain decisions was a huge thing and made a big difference. The monitor's office, which at one point, Alva worked for the monitor, had 50 people in the office. 50 people. All of this was paid by the agriculture. The agriculture department, all the arbitrators, all the adjudicators, all the neutrals, the monitor's office, which is another reason that the new case is structured differently, I think. 22,000 people were found eligible to participate in the claims process. 69% prevailed, 15,645 in track A. 169 people were successful. 62% of 169, or 104 people, were successful in track B. 5,848 claims were the subject of the petition for re-examination. And the monitor directed re-examination of approximately 2,941, or 50% of the claims. The government provided a total of $1.06 billion in cash relief. It's the largest civil rights settlement in history at that point. And the other thing that had to happen for all of this to take place was for Congress to extend the statute of limitations so that people could go back more than 2 years or 3 years or whatever the statute of limitations was. There were, and I'm going to make two more points and then I'll stop. There were roughly 60,000 people who didn't file claims, who filed petitions for late filing. There was a part of the settlement agreement, the consent decree, paragraph 5G, which said that if you missed out on filing, you file a late claim under 5G, the judge will decide whether to let you in this case. Well, I wasn't going to do that. 60,000 of these things. So, once again, I delegated to Michael Lewis the responsibility. And as the argument was made that they didn't have notice, they didn't hear about it, and all of this. And again, those of you that have studied class actions in Rule 23 of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure know that in order to approve a settlement of class action, the judge has to find certain things. And among the things that the judge has to find is that the notice to potential class members is adequate. And I have found that it was, so it would be very difficult for me to turn around and say that it wasn't. The notice in the second case was not only adequate, but it was phenomenal. And Andy will get to that, I'm sure. But what we did do, so Michael essentially set up a software program because he was originally doing this. What are the potential categories? So if you missed the file because there was a death in the family or a illness or a flood or a hurricane, I mean, remember some of these farmers live far away from the mailboxes or the post office. Or whatever. So how many people came in late filing? Under 3,000 were admitted for late filings out of the 60,000. And that's what gets to the second case that I would like to end by mentioning J.L. Chestnut again. what I said in remarks at his funeral, or I wasn't there, my remarks were read. I said the black farmer's case is the most significant matter I've been involved in during my 14 years as a judge, and perhaps in my entire legal career. Was the largest civil rights settlement in the history of the country, and so far it has provided over $1 million to more than 15,000 African-American farmers. This did not make them whole, not by any means, but it provided some measure of justice and reparation for the decades of discrimination that was visited upon them. Reparation of decades, maybe decades were visited. But anyway, their parents and their grandparents by the United States Department of Agriculture. Of course, nothing can completely undo the discrimination of the past to restore the lost lands or the lost opportunity for thousands of African-American farmers. J.L. wrote me in a letter shortly after I approved the settlement of the black farmers case in the spring of 1999. And he said, "The unprecedented impact of your order across the Deep South is difficult to describe. That difficult and troubled world is light years away from contemplative privacy of your courthouse. As I travel about the South, meeting with black farmers, I see new hope in tired eyes and new energy in feeble bodies and souls. Surely a blow for liberty has been struck. Hundreds of poor, marginal black farm families, literally at the end of their rope, have their hope restored. The Federation of Black Farm Organizations wrote about two black farm fathers who seriously contemplated suicide, but are now busy preparing to reopen their dormant farm operation as a result of the case. This case represents one of the most important milestones in civil rights history since Brown versus the Board of Education in 1954. The Republic really is no stronger than its weakest links, and this case has strengthened many of those links." That's
J.L. Wow.
Before Michael
Lewis I'm just going to take directions from that guy. You know,
I want to backfill one thing, just because to understand what is
my glass.
I'm sorry.
And move
on. To understand what this discrimination was and is probably. Understand that some of you probably have experienced families who have farmed or whatever, but to farm you need credit because the cycle of when you need to fix your equipment and buy your seed is out of sync with when you harvest and earn. And so, as part of the New Deal in the 1930s, largely, some before that, but particularly then, it was understood that the federal government had to play a major role in extending credit to farmers to make that part of the economy work. The compact that that the Roosevelt administration struck to get that through a Congress that was largely, there was a substantial power among Southern senators, was that all the programs would be administered locally. Okay, so federal money is given out locally through all, and there's a lot of good reason for that, because the people who are on the ground in the areas know the needs and know, okay, but the complexion of skin in those local offices in the South, right through, modern times, led to virulent and pervasive and disgusting discrimination. And when Judge Friedman talks about applications being African-American farmers were spit at when they came in, they would walk in, they would walk in the loan office, he said there's no more money here, their next door neighbor would walk in with a loan with $25,000, no questions asked, they were white, okay. The actual stories are horrific. So it was against that backdrop, understanding the importance of farm credit, and how did it happen that the federal government was complicit in that discrimination, largely in the South, not entirely, but largely in the South. And that, I think, is when the Department of Agriculture finally got honest with itself, and it was really in the Clinton administration, and of course Clinton being a son of the South, I think really spoke to, he understood this. He understood this in a very deep kind of way. So that's why it was such and as you point out, Judge Friedman, it required, I mean, all the lawyering and the judging and the neutraling and all in the world wouldn't have happened without the political commitment of the administration and Congress at various places. And I'm going to talk about some of the next kind of layers of that of the politics.
As well, I hope about, Alva's actually been, Andy's been at a lot of meetings too, filling out claims and stuff, but Alva's really been, over the last decade or more, in huge numbers of meetings of black farmers in the South and talking to people. One of her jobs when she worked for the monitor's office, and one of the things she's been doing as Deputy Ombudsman as well, is talking to people on the phone and talking to people in person, and talking to a lot of people whose claims were denied, and telling them. I mean, it's very hard. You can speak for yourself, but I am a great fan of hers for many reasons. But one of them is that, it's, you know, when you say to somebody, as I said a minute ago, you got $50,000, that's better than zero, okay. But when you say to somebody, you went through this whole process and you got nothing, but the process itself was fair, and sitting down and trying to explain that, she has been in the trenches a lot.
Thank you. I'm going to pick up with the 66,000, the 60,000 that didn't get in the Pigford case by the initial deadline. They complained, which I definitely could understand, that they didn't know about the deadline. You know, at the time, notice was the big issue. I mean, there were other reasons, but notice was the big issue. I believe when they gave notice in the first case, they put it in Jet Magazine and BET. And honestly, I didn't hear about the case, and I was a lawyer, public defender in Minnesota until 2002. I was telling Andy, I was in the middle of a trial that didn't look like it was going well. I stayed up all night. I found the technicality. I was so happy because I knew I was getting this case dismissed. I walked into court the next morning. My client didn't show up. So there was a bench warrant out for her arrest, even though they dismissed the case. So I went storming out in the parking lot after the hearing, and I was just talking to myself where people could hear me. And I looked around. You know how you do, you look around and you don't see anybody and you're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe this. Well, in the parking lot, I ran into the person who's general counsel for the monitor's office, a wonderful man who passed away Kid on Saffold. He happened to be there for jury duty. And he saw me just stomping my feet, and he came up to me and he said, would you like to get involved in the Pigford case? A week later, after I met with the monitor, I was working for the monitor's office. That's how I got in. Prior to that, I hadn't heard about the Black Caucus case. I didn't watch BET. It watched me some nights, but I didn't know anything about the case. And I didn't watch, I didn't look at Jet Magazine because, that was always in the barbershop. And I had hair back then, so I was never in the barbershop. So initially, when I started working on the case, they put me in charge of claimant services, where I actually spoke with a lot of the claimants. And they wanted, or they felt that we could go beyond the consent decree and let them in because of the lack of notice. And so we couldn't do anything. We felt for them, but we just couldn't do anything. And so they took it outside of the parties of the case, and they contacted farm advocacy groups, their state senators, civil rights organizations, other attorneys. And before we knew it, in 2004, there was a congressional hearing. And with respect to the parties in the case, they took testimony from the monitor, from the claimant, from Al Pires, and one of the claimants. And what they came away with was it was lack of notice and inadequate representation by class counsel that caused the 66,000 or 60,000 people not to get in the case. In the meantime, after the second deadline for these late filers, thousands and thousands of people files late claims, and we categorize those people as late filers, people who came in after the September 2000 deadline. So once that happened in 2004, some time went by, and we were still getting inundated. The court, class counsel, the monitor's office, Michael Lewis, just with letters saying, please let us into the case. And unfortunately, we had to continue to send letters, and I spoke with people saying, I'm sorry, the deadline has passed. There's nothing we can do. We can't go beyond the consent decree. Well, in 2006 and in 2007, Senator Allen Habib, I believe, from Virginia, and Senator Grassley from Iowa introduced a bill to address the late filers and the late filers. And in 2007, President Obama, at the time Senator, co-sponsored the Grassley bill. In addition, he introduced a bill where he interpreted how this should be addressed. And they all failed. They couldn't get it passed. And so that brings us up to 2008 and what Congress did do to address the late filers and the late filers. They put a few sentences in the 2008 Farm Bill that created an avenue not to reopen the Pigford case. And a lot of people initially felt as if the case should be reopened under the same terms of the original case, but they didn't do that. They said, we're gonna create a new case called it kind of Pigford II, and Andy's gonna pick up from there, but it allowed them an opportunity to have their cases heard. The problem is they only allocated $100 million, and we're talking about 60 plus thousands of farmers who needed to have their claims heard. During this process of waiting to see if there was going to be a new case or if they were going to reopen the case, I traveled throughout the South with my colleague, Stephen Carpenter, who's the ombudsman in this case, in Ray Black Farmers, but he was also senior counsel in the Pigford case. And you had to be there to really understand the plight of the Black farmer and their ancestors. What was disheartening is that there was a process that was set up that you had to go through some steps before you even had the opportunity to tell your story. And a lot of people were weeded out as a result because they couldn't comply with the process. And so when people tell me, It's not fair. I don't disagree with them. I don't say, yes, it is. I never do that. I said, I'm not going to argue with you because, but the law is the law. Just because, Your Honor, forgive me, but just because it's legal doesn't make it fair. You know, that's just how it is. So we get to this process, I think it was a step in the right direction for Congress to do what they did. And on June 18, 2008, President Bush signed the 2008 Farm Bill. It opened up a new opportunity. And people can argue that it wasn't enough. None of us are going to argue that it was enough. But it was a step in the right direction. The intentions of everyone were decent. They were trying to rectify systemic discrimination that had been happening for years and years and years. Is it the best? No, but it's better. It was a great start. It was better than what had been happening, because at the time, between 1983, I believe, to 1997, USDA had did away with the appeals process. So as Andy had discussed, a lot of these just unbelievable things were happening to these farmers when they tried to get loans, and no one could do anything about it. And that was one of the other reasons why some people, a large group of people who were part of the 60,000+, did not file a claim one time. They felt like, well, what's the point? There's no records. We can't prove anything. And we did learn in the monitor's office that USDA would archive their records, and they destroyed the records. They're completely destroyed. And as Judge Friedman discussed, finding a similar situated white farmer wasn't going to be easy as we thought. So a lot of people didn't even apply. They're like, what's the point? Also, a lot of people didn't trust that this was a legitimate case.
Which is, I think I made the point. I think one of the reasons 60,000 people didn't file, it's some subset of that 60,000 didn't file, is because they didn't trust that this was a legitimate case, that they had been screwed over so many times, if you'll excuse me, by their government, that they didn't think this was going to be any better. It came to the point where when I did sign an order, whether it was a favorable one or not so favorable one, now that we have electronic filings in all the courts, you don't actually sign it, you don't actually have to sign it. But the lawyers, and Andy said this to me too, but the lawyers in the other case said, would you make sure that the order is filed with your actual signature on it? Because if they don't see your actual signature on it, they won't believe it's a real court order. And if you're out of town, don't have another judge sign for you. They want to see your signature. I mean, whether they loved me or hated me or somewhere in between doesn't matter. But
they knew who you were.
They knew who I was. And nothing else seemed legitimate, right?
That's right. Absolutely. And the other part that was going on in this process is that there started being people out, unfortunately, in the South, who started having their meetings, naming their organization similar to the lawsuit, calling it Black Farmers, whatever, and they started charging people. They would take their copies of the deed or the actual deed to their land. They would take their Social Security number. They would do these affidavits, fill out these applications, give them a survey, and it looked legitimate. It really did. We started getting these letters in the monitor's office, and these were people like, look, see, I did apply. I did this one time, and it turned out it was a scam, and it continues to this day. I had two calls just yesterday about meetings throughout the South scheduled where thousands of people are showing up and they're giving $100. Some people have paid as much as $500 at a meeting. And for some people, they've been paying since 2004. And they blame the process because they think that we had something to do with it. There was a connection, and it wasn't. So, you have to understand that while there's deadlines in place, you can understand why some people were like, no, I'm not going to do this, because they didn't know it was legitimate or not.
Just one footnote to what happened in Congress. Again, it's interesting, the coalition of people that came together, some people from farm states, some people from southern states, but everybody was supporting this. And it's very important things in addition to what Alva said. First of all, once again, they waived the statute of limitations to let people who have been discriminated against way early on, and if you filed a lawsuit within 2 years of this law being signed by the president, you were in. And even if your claims went back all the way to 1981. Secondly, the original draft of the legislation said you may file a lawsuit in a United States District Court. And Randy, the monitor, told me this, and I said, you know, nobody wants 94 different districts and judges, maybe more than 94 judges, say. So I said, this is really a statement against interest.
But
go back up to the Hill and tell them to change it so that the lawsuit is filed in the United States District Court for the District of Columbia.
Which he knew and everyone knew meant it was coming to Judge Friedman.
And so, and I went to the chief judge, I said, if there are a bunch of class actions, I'll take them. But if there are, in fact, 60,000 separate lawsuits, no. But anyway, it all worked out because, you know, like Alva and Stephen, I had spent a dozen years on this stuff, and I no need to at the wheel, and I'll leave the room, and Andy can tell you what the lawyers think about the judge. But, so Congress did that, and then the other thing they did, they only authorized, I can never remember the distinction between authorization and appropriation, $100 million. It's going to go nowhere. But they left open the possibility for coming up with more money later. And I think a lot of people were skeptical about it. But Andy and others, including some people at the Justice Department, made it happen. So that's all I can say.
So let me start. First, thanks for coming out and listening to this. We've all been living this, and we do want to leave some time for questions, so hopefully we won't talk too long. But let me tell you first how I got involved. The biography, by the way, here talked about my practicing law in Florida, which I now do. I split my time between D.C. and Florida, so they got the Florida piece. But I was a partner at the D.C. firm of Kroll & Mooring for 26 years. And in the course of having an active litigation practice there, and as Shelley said, active in the bar, I did a number of pro bono cases, working largely with Washington Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights, some high profile cases, and had, I think, developed a reputation for liking big cases and also having a good reputation of being able to work effectively with and against the Department of Justice. There were, as Alva said, in that period of time leading up to the 2008 Farm Bill, and the way it got passed, by the way, it got this got buried in an omnibus Farm Bill. And you have the politics of all this. You know, you sometimes in law school you think about cases and what's right and what's wrong. This is the politics is what has made this case allow Judge Friedman and Alva and I and now the UDC School of Law to do its thing. Because without the political will to extend the statute of limitations, to fund this, terrible history of discrimination would go unaddressed. So I got a call one day from a lawyer in North Carolina who said, we've been following these cases and have actually signed up 30,000 black farmers as potential clients. Not all of whom are likely to be affected by this law, but many of them are. And the legislation just come out, and it's going to be filed. It has to be filed in the District of Columbia. And we need someone who knows that court, who's a member of the District of Columbia Bar, who knows anyway. And are you interested? And I'm going to tell you something, Judge. I don't know if you probably suspect this, but and I said no. Okay. And the reason I said no was because, and this is very important. This is a sort of teaching moment because you have to look at some of the economics of a case like this as well. And Congress had only appropriated $100 million. And there was no attorney's fee provision. See, one of the big differences between this, the first case was a civil rights case under the civil rights laws with an attorney's fee provision, and all the judgments got paid out of what's called the judgment fund. So it was unlimited. It was $1 billion, but it could have been $10 billion. It was unlimited. This was special legislation. There was no civil rights statute involved. So there was no right for any attorney to be paid a penny, no matter how much they worked. And it looked like this case may only be $100 million in this case. And it was going to be, I could see, a very complicated case. And I was working in a large law firm, and I had responsibility to the law firm. I just couldn't say, well, I'll do it no matter what's involved. And so I actually said, no, I would like to help, but I just can't do that. It's not set up right. And the lawyers came back to me, and they said, we're willing to take the risk. We'll pay you on an hourly basis. Okay? And so we negotiated an hourly rate, on which I did this work. And then I was able to go to my firm and say, you know, we can do this on a way that makes sense. I have no idea how long it's going to go. I have no idea how much, and I don't know whether the lawyers will actually ever be able to pay me. Okay, so we were plenty of risk. It was small firms, and it was a lot of risk, but at least it was something that made some sense. But that key point of the economics will come in later as a practical thing when you're handling a case like this. But this new law passed in 2008 was great, except, first of all, it was limited to people who had put in a late claim in the Pigford case. So there were tens of thousands of farmers who were the victims of discrimination, maybe even worse discrimination than people who put in the claims. But this legislation didn't help them. And the settlement that we arrived at all just couldn't help them. It was a lot better than nothing, but it certainly didn't go back and help people who either never filed the claims or didn't hear about the case or didn't trust the government or whatever. Secondly, as Judge Friedman noted, this put all these claims in court, and each one of these claims, even though the statute created a fairly low standard of proof, but as structured, every one of those claims would have to be adjudicated by a judge. There's no way, unless we could get a settlement of the case where the government would buy into some non-judicial adjudication, we were looking at the possibility of shutting down the District of Columbia District Court because you would have tens of thousands of claims, and if each one took 3 hours, and you multiply that out by 50,000 claims, we'd shut the court down. I mean, the court couldn't do it, right?
That's true.
The other thing that was really challenging, so everyone knew that we had to try and find a settlement, but we couldn't settle the case for $100 million. Because at that time we assumed that there wouldn't be 60,000, but maybe be 40,000, and just to do the math, 40,000 into 100 million is $2,500 a piece. But more importantly, you had to also take out the $100 million. The lawyers had to get paid something, and you had to be able to pay for a claims administrator and notice and adjudicators. And $100 million goes nowhere. By the time all that happens, no matter how efficiently you do it, so the whole case would depend on somehow getting enough money that it would make it work, getting the government to agree to a non-judicial process. And the trickiest thing in many ways was the fact that whatever sum of money we got was going to be limited, as called, and therefore. We had to assume that not everyone was going to get paid in full. And by the way, the legislation made the promise that you would get paid the same thing that if you won under the new legislation, you'd get paid the same thing as you got paid Pigford, $50,000 plus $12,500. Well, if there's not enough money, does the first person who wins their claim get paid? What happens to the last person? Okay, you have to set up a process, a limited fund that basically makes sure everyone gets treated the same. Well, there were real questions about whether this was or was not appropriate for a class action. It cried out for class action, but as we know, the appellate courts and the Supreme Court have really tightened down on what is certifiable as Rule 23, even if something makes sense and you know it should be a class action. The one thing we didn't want to have is we want to come to Judge Friedman, persuade him, and he's not going to take, he's going to look at it really hard, but persuade him that it's certified as a class, have build a whole thing on this and have it go get be reversed. I mean, that would be the biggest disaster of all. So there were huge Rule 23 questions. And although I've handled class actions, I should say, this case is not only, I think, for me, I share with you, kind of, I think, the most significant case I've worked on in 30 years, but I think the hardest. Not because, I mean, I've tried hard cases, okay? I've argued in the Supreme Court. I've had the privilege of lots of non-illegal questions. This case was so hard because it had so many moving pieces and there were so many uncertainties. And the other part that's hard is we had 20 law firms involved. And unless we could get all 20 law firms on the same page, nothing was going to happen. Okay? And the dynamics of trying to work with a group, and the lawyers were all in for the best of reasons, but they also want to get paid. Okay? And how do you structure a settlement? And we had we had difference of opinion what the settlement should look like, so I had to get everyone for we could negotiate, the lead lawyers could negotiate with the Justice Department, we had to get everyone on board what the settlement looked like. But then before we could get something signed, we actually had to have an agreement of how all the fees, we had no idea what, if any, fees would be approved. We knew that they would come to Judge Friedman. In the settlement agreement, there was a provision of a band of what could be awarded. We had no idea what the judge would do with it, but we had to have an agreement that with everybody, or nearly everybody, we didn't get everyone, nearly everybody, of what would happen. So these are never show up in the reports. The judge kind of knows they're happening, but doesn't know what's happening. And it's really hard work, I got to tell you. But without getting all that in place, none of this happens. So we finally got, it took us a year and a half to negotiate the settlement.
And the Congress, I'm never going to get to this, but Congress then essentially said they would appropriate more money if the case, well, this came later, right?
Go ahead. Yeah.
At some point, they presented a settlement agreement, and then Congress said, you can tell us how we got there. Congress said, we're going to appropriate X amount more money, but only if the case settles, somebody put in the right word, substantially along the lines of the agreement they had negotiated. So it comes to me at some point, and I guess I jumped ahead.
Yeah, that's
story.
Okay, go ahead, yeah.
It comes to me with the notion that if I approve the settlement, we'll have $1.25 billion. If I don't approve the settlement, we'll have $100 million, the original amount. And so when people came in to object to the settlement, and this would normally never come up in a Rule 23 argument, in terms of deciding the terms of Rule 23 are, is it fair, adequate, and reasonable? One of the factors that went into whether it's fair, adequate, and reasonable for me was even if I don't like all the provisions,
right?
If I approve it in substantially the form they submitted it to me, the farmers would have $1.25 billion less expenses of various kinds. But if I found it objectionable and there was no settlement, there'd only be $100 million. But anyway,
No. Well, so just I'll tell you one other just complication, just because I think if any of you studied, ethics and Rule 23, one of the things we came across that was really naughty was the fact that when you looked at the legislation, there were reasonable people who disagreed as to whether the late-lates that Alva mentioned, those who filed their claims after 2000, were actually intended to be beneficiaries of this legislation, or only the people who filed in that before 2000. And that meant that we actually had essentially two subclasses. Because if the late-lates weren't included, that meant that the lates would get more money. And there were more lates than late-lates. But the late-lates wanted to be in. And so one of the things we had to do, we had to take a step back. We had to go get some other lawyers to come and in the negotiations, represent the late-lates, and we had to duke it out. And we finally came up with the late-lates got a discount if there wasn't enough money to go around, and it worked out okay. And by the way, I'll come to this in a second. It turns out, let me, in order. So we got the settlement finally in February 2010, but it's all conditioned on getting more money. And so we're working, then all of our interest then turns to the politics. And we're working, you know, as closely as we can with leadership on Capitol Hill, with the White House, with the Justice Department, the Department of Agriculture, to try and get some more money. Well, 2010, some of you may remember, was not was a tough year for getting more money out of Congress. Not that there have been a lot of years since then that are easy, but 2010, just for context, that was the year of the Tea Party. Okay, November 2010 was the backlash against big government and spending, and the bill to get this more money is just not going anywhere. And the clock is ticking, and this Congress is going out of session in January 2011, and we're in December 2010, and you know, there are four or five more legislative days, and we don't know. And everything hangs on whether the politics will come together, and they came together at the very last minute. So once they appropriated, Congress passed something called the Claims Resolution Act of 2010. It also included something about a big Native American case, so it dealt with two ongoing big pieces of litigation. But Congress, and particularly the Republicans who were deeply suspicious or worse about whether it was appropriate, any of these claims were appropriate or real, and the word fraud got thrown around a lot. Anyway, the quid pro quo, if you will, the price of this legislation, they insisted on putting in some anti-fraud provisions into the legislation, which we were fine with, okay? But it did increase an overlay. They not only required the General Accounting Office to do an audit of the whole claims process, but they also put the Inspector General of the Department of Agriculture to do an audit, two audits. Those are still ongoing, by the way. They also insisted that any lawyer who signed a claims form, okay, basically did so at a risk of criminal prosecution if it turned out to be fraudulent. I was successful in getting the actual language watered down a little bit so that all the lawyers didn't quit before we started the claims process.
And the people, the neutrals who were adjudicating the claims,
yeah,
for the first time, the legislation required that they take an oath of office administered by a federal judge. So if you were going to be one of the people to decide the validity of a claim, you were sworn in under oath, whatever, by a federal judge. So that was a nice, had a signed an order appointing them. And then just one other little thing about it. But some of these adjudicators were in other parts of the country. So I had to prevail on my judge friends elsewhere and explain the case to them and give them the language and give them the form of order. And they traipsed down to the federal courthouse in San Francisco or someplace, or Montgomery, Alabama.
So now we can come back to Judge Friedman. Okay, we've got funding, he said, which was conditioned on. I mean, the good part was that Congress had effectively approved the settlement. I'm not sure they necessarily thought of it that way, but they had approved the settlement, which was pretty remarkable because they said, "We'll give you the money if the settlement is substantially this form." So then we had to run through the whole formal, very structured, very important Rule 23 process, presenting to Judge Friedman, asking him to review it, and he has to. He can't give a rubber stamp. It's a very deep and critical review to make sure he's satisfied. Of course, given his history of the case, he knows the case better than all of us, and he has lots of questions and suggestions, and we have to try and work to accommodate those. He says, I'll preliminarily approve it. Then we have to do the notice, and as you said, I mean, given what happened the first time around, we spent over $2 million notice and hired the best people around. And anyway, the notice, and then we come to a hearing, an all-day hearing, that where anybody who wants to be heard is heard, and many were heard. And after that process, then Judge Friedman took under advisement in October of 2011, wrote a very extensive opinion. Anyone who wants it, Shelley, tell me who to send it to, and we can make it. It's a great opinion, but it really gives you some of the history and context of this. And then the hard part starts. Okay? The hard part starts because we now have to set up a claims process to complete in 180 days. Because the one thing I just want to say, my mantra
from the day I said I would take on this case, is there are three things that we have to, that are going to guide everything we do. Fairness, efficiency, and integrity. You probably heard me say that a number of times. And those three don't always, are not always compatible. Okay, what's fair is not always efficient, and what's efficient is not always fair. And to guard integrity of the process sometimes is unfair, because it means some people who have got good claims are going to get cut out because you have to be guarding against the risk. So, but that was our mantra, and we were going to live by that mantra, and everyone did. But so now we have to have a claims process, and the mailing is actually going to go out to over 100,000 potential people. Because it's actually more than 60,000 who might be eligible. And our promise to the judge and to the class was that anybody who wanted a lawyer had a lawyer. Okay, we would put enough lawyers on the ground in the field that, because we knew that people who consulted a lawyer at no cost to them had a much better chance of having a claim approved than those who filed pro se. Unfortunately, tens of thousands of people filed pro se, and a very large number of them didn't have their claims approved. And tens of thousands filed with the assistance of a lawyer, and their percentage was much, much higher. But, you know, we held, and this I take no credit for, this small little firm in North Carolina that engaged me had the most amazing logistical skill set and organized all these law firms, and we have 383 meetings in 24 states and District of Columbia, in 100 group meetings in 180 days, and we were able to help over roughly 25,000 people. That was amazing, and I take no credit for that at all. That was really a team of people that did that and worked really, really hard. Long the short, and then these neutrals that we talked about, former judges and experienced arbitrators, reviewed every single claim with a lot of quality control because they knew they were going to be audited, and that process took longer than we thought, but it took what it took, and remember, going back, we could not send a check to anybody until we knew exactly how many people were going to prevail because we had a limited fund. So you had to finish the whole process before you could pay anybody. But we finished the whole process and presented the findings to Judge Friedman, and he approved the payment. And in September of 2013, the process of paying out approximately over $1 billion in claims started. And we thought, we really tried so hard to think of everything to make sure, but one of the things that we just didn't do enough thinking about was how difficult this was going to be for the people receiving the money to deal with the taxes. And that revelation, which I am, you know, abashed to say, I didn't fully appreciate. None of us did. But when we realized, and Craig is going to talk a little bit about how important this is and how much help these folks need, I turned to Shelley and I said, "Can you guys help us?"
Thank you. You know, I get this call, I guess about 18 months ago, from Andy, and he says, you know, the Black Farmer case. Yeah, sure, blah, blah, blah. So those folks all need kind of to know about the tax consequences. And I remember from the board meeting you talking about the low-income taxpayer clinic. You know, can we get together and talk about what, you know, could the law school maybe, you know, what might happen? And I thought, taxes? Absolutely, you know. So, I don't know anything about taxes, but I have people who know about taxes. And so I went to the then director of the Low Income Taxpayer Clinic, Charles Jean. Charles and Andy had many, many conversations about what we might do. We're not able to represent people in tax controversies or cases across the country, but what we can do is provide information and guidance about where to go to get help and the fact that you do need help. And so we worked up some initial thinking about it. And then, of course, like everything in the law and life, it got delayed. So flash forward a year, Andy calls again and says, so we're getting close to, I think we might, well, by this time Amanda and Rachel are on the job, and I call Amanda Dunlap and Rachel Hune and say, so by the day after tomorrow, could we put together some bullet points of what we might be able to do? We literally were brainstorming through frequently asked questions would be good, and how about like a video would be, how about a radio, you know, a telephone call-in center? So Amanda and Rachel put together a very concise little plan, which Andy presented, and the co-counsel in the Justice Department folks looked at it and said, okay, that looks like a good plan. That seems okay. And then, you know, flash forward, time goes by, and now it's January.
Well, let me say, again, the dirty little secret of time go by is someone's got to pay for this, okay? And that required an adjustment to the settlement agreement, okay? There's some side prey money we expect, but as Judge Friedman said, the settlement agreement, you can't change it without both sides agreeing. And here's one where, frankly, you know, I'll say it out loud, the Justice Department just dragged their heels. They just were not focusing on the timing and the importance of this. And so it put us in this crunch because it took too many months to get sign off on it. But we finally got the sign off, or enough of a thumbs up, we were said, the hell that we're going with it. And that's what we started up.
So literally, I talked to Amanda and she says, well, we're running the whole clinic right now. We will need help. Okay. But we have help. I think within a day, we signed Craig up to help implement this plan. And meanwhile, I'm home recovering from surgery, so this is all happening on the telephone. At which point I realize, so where do we get the money to pay them? At which point Andy and I talked, okay, we're going to ultimately be able to get the money, but let's get the money, let's have the law school's foundation advance the money so that we can actually pay Craig and Rachel and those who were going to be participating to get this done. And so, you know, it's like watching sausage made or legislation, and it ain't pretty. But our foundation executive board came together and really were delighted to agree to participate and support this effort. Andy went back to the drawing board and they've now agreed that the lawyers will agree to front the money to the foundation so that we can pay it. The foundation's not out, and the lawyers understand that you know, although you want every single claimant to get their money, you know, some are just not going to cash the checks. And even if you don't cash one $50,000 check or two, that will ultimately be the side prey money that will pay for the efforts that the law school did. So we knew that this would happen. It's just that it was a little ugly there for a minute. But flash forward, Craig walks in. Under that shirt, there's a red S, you know, and he just dove in, literally. He, you know, I don't know if you remember the snowstorms. He lived here. He may or may not have lived here through the snowstorms, manning with our first year students.
I did have a cot in the basement.
Don't tell the dean. Excellent news. That's on camera. he organized our first year community service students, our alums, and so forth. So talk about, you want to lead with the video, which might kind of set it up a little bit.
Sure, we can lead with a video that our distinguished SBA president, Bob Newman.
Farmer Bob.
Farmer Bob was kind enough to help us make I am fully confident that Bob will succeed in a legal career and ultimately run for some political office, and I will vote for him. If failing that, though, we have just launched his athlete career.
Yeah.
This is a very, very short informational video we put together. It's nuts and bolts. It's meant to communicate some very basic tax information to settlement recipients. I'll go ahead and just play it, and then we'll talk about some of the other components of our project. So here it is.
Craig, could I might help if you just said what you told me, and I've learned from you, is the level of sophistication or the lack thereof of many of the people who you've been dealing with and calling you just so different than what we might expect.
Sure. Yeah. And just to, as a kind of way of introduction to some of these remarks, it's so interesting to me hearing you all, this prestigious panel, talking about this case on such a macro level. And we're on the other end. We're on the micro individual level. Everything that you have talked about has taken place. Settlements have been agreed upon. Payments have been made. And now it's time to pay taxes. And that's where we came from. I think everybody might have been wondering, what does all this have to do with taxes? And what it has to do with is that the settlement money each of these recipients received is taxable income. And a lot of folks didn't know that. And it was our job to get very valuable information out to this settlement class so that they can take care of their tax obligations in a responsible way.
You had told me how many have never filed taxes. Okay, yeah. People have never filed taxes, don't know what a 1040 looks like, don't have 1099, no idea. I mean, the foreign concepts that this is complicated, and yet their foundation level of information and knowledge and experience is really, really small.
It's true. When we were trying to, in a very short period of time, come up with a program that would provide useful information to these settlement recipients, we had to look at who they are, look at what their individual circumstances would be so that we could tailor our program to providing them with the most applicable information to their individual situations. And as we all know, everybody's tax circumstances are individual to them. But we had to sort of look at this, this class of 16,000 recipients and recognize that their awareness levels span the entire spectrum, from some people who are very well-informed, savvy, consistent filers, to others who had never filed taxes a day in their life. And so we had to take that full spectrum and tailor our program to the most amount of people. And it's true. Looking at this demographic of settlement recipients, small-scale, independent African-American farmers living and working in often very rural and remote regions. Most are retired. Elderly people, often living on very modest fixed income, generally from Social Security and sometimes supplemental security income. And those facts were key to our program because we listened to them. We tried to tailor our program to their individual needs. And it was a learning process. We, as Dean Brodrick said, we jumped in, and in one day, I think the third day of our hotline being open, we had something like 655 calls. And very, very quickly, we adjusted our program. We had to. Professor Dunlap and Rachel and myself, we all sat down ahead of time, and we had a pretty good anticipatory list of what these settlement recipients, taxpayers' needs would be. And some of those were right on the mark. But then we also had to adjust our stride once we finally started talking with a lot of individuals. And we did that. We adapted to try to meet what their individual needs were. Let me just talk a little bit.
Run the video real quick.
Yeah, yeah,
so
sure.
So people can get a sense
Andy's
of what
getting
the
me ahead of my mind.
No, I just wanted to, I'm sorry. I thought
that's
I
good.
Think, now you'll, I think with that background, the video will have more context.
Sure. So It is very basic information, but this is information that we determined that these settlement recipients wouldn't have otherwise. So let me play the video.